Presenting a case of a 23-year-old woman, a homemaker and a resident of Bihar, who came with complaints of a lump in the upper abdomen for the past 4 years, along with two episodes of yellowish discoloration of her eyes, 6 months and 2 months back. The patient was apparently well till 4 years back when she started noticing a lump in the upper right side of her abdomen. Initially, the size of the swelling was about 5 to 5 centimeters, which gradually progressed over time to the current size of 15 to 15 centimeters. There is no history of any rapid increase in size, and there is no history of decrease in size of the lump. She started having pain over the lump for the past 7 months, which was continuous non-colicky over the upper abdomen. There were no aggravating or relieving factors. There was no history of radiation of pain, and there was no relation of pain to food intake. She also complains of yellowish discoloration of her eyes and body for the past 6 months, which lasted for about 10 days. It was associated with itching all over the body and with high-colored urine. It was not associated with fever or pale-colored stools. She had similar episodes of yellowish discoloration 3 months back, associated with itching and high-colored urine, which also lasted for about 10 days. She did not have any yellowish discoloration in between the two episodes. Currently, she does not complain of any yellowish discoloration or itching. She has no history of vomiting, no history of alteration of bowel habits. There's no history of melena. There's no history of loss of appetite or weight loss. There's no history of... contact with dogs. There's no history of history suggestive of metastasis. She had gone to a traditional practitioner for the lump about a year back, for which branding was done twice over her lower abdomen, and she received some herbal medications for her jaundice. She takes painkillers occasionally for the pain. She has no previous history of any surgeries, tuberculosis, diabetes, or hypertension. There's no history of blood transfusions or any high-risk behavior. Her sleep, appetite, bowel, bladder habits are normal. She consumes a mixed diet. There's no history of smoking or alcohol consumption. She attained menarche at 14 years with normal menstrual cycles, and her last menstrual cycle was 10 days back. She has no history of similar complaints in the family and no history of malignancy-related deaths in the family. To summarize the history, it's a 23-year-old woman who complains of a large 15 to 15, slow-growing lump in the right upper side of her abdomen, associated with non-colicky pain, along with two episodes of obstructed jaundice 6 months and 3 months back, which resolved spontaneously.
So based on the history, what do you think are we dealing with?
Ma'am, it's a young woman who complains of a slow progressive large lump over the past four years. So which is in the upper right side of the abdomen.
So most probably. Do you see anything in the history that talks about whether we're dealing with an inflammatory or a malignant pathology or what? Any organ that you think could be involved?
Yes, ma'am. Considering the slow growth over 4 years, it's most probably a benign pathology, and it's a non-malignant benign pathology. Since she also has two episodes of obstructed jaundice, we could relate the pathology to hepatobiliary.
How would you say it's obstructive jaundice? So episodes?
She had two episodes along with itching and high-colored urine, sir.
So can you tell us some benign pathologies in which intermittent jaundice can happen?
They can be hemolytic conditions like spherocytic anemias, where
they
can
produce obstructive jaundice.
Not obstructive jaundice, that's a pre-hepatic.
No, I am focused on that. With non-colicky pain, so it is dull ache.
Dull aching pain.
Dull ache means solid organ.
Yes.
Colicky means?
Luminal organ.
Okay, it was in the previous case also I was asking. How do you differentiate a colicky pain from a non-colicky pain? If you run into a fossil, he might ask you a question this.
A colicky pain, like a small bowel colicky pain, will be associated.
I didn't ask you small bowel. Describe a colicky pain.
As the muscles contract, there is an increase in intensity of the pain with the
colicky pain is when there is a period of when there is like the pain comes and it goes, and there is a period.
So waxing and waning.
And it is associated with, like on examination, there will be bradycardia and...
Does it have vomiting with it?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
What is the cause of vomiting in a colicky pain? Say it is urinary colic.
So because of the parasympathetic stimulation?
Yes, because of pyelorospasm due to parasympathetic stimulation. So colicky pain is classically waxing and waning. Please understand, all of you, if you are asked this question and if you don't answer, there is a problem. Colicky pain is due to obstruction in a tube. So proximal to the tube is trying to obstruction, the tube is trying to have hyperperistalsis. What is hyperperistalsis? More parasympathetic activity. More means it will come in waves and end there. It will be relieved on application of pressure. These are things which should be described. Inflammatory pain is made worse on application of pressure. Three, it will be associated with vomiting because there is a reflex spasm of the vagus. And vagus supplies as it divides into two. First, the hepatic branch, which gives off a pyloric branch. So, pyloric supply, there is a pyloric spasm. And classically, colicky pain will be associated with a non-bilious vomiting. And that has nothing to do with the reverse peristalsis. It's a wrong answer if you're giving it anywhere. Thirdly, patient will have on examination bradycardia rather than tachycardia and inflammatory pain. But important point is that it's relieved on application of pressure and inflammatory pain is made worse on application of pressure. It waxes and wanes, that is persisting. And thirdly, there is tachycardia versus bradycardia there and associated vomiting. Yes. This is how you differentiate the two. Please take a note of it, write it down somewhere and remember it for future. Clear? Okay. So you are describing the non-colicky pain, that means dull aching pain.
Yes.
Am I right? With two episodes of obstructive jaundice. You're being very specific, that's why I'm asking you. If you had mentioned two episodes of jaundice and discussed it later, maybe I would have asked you less. Why do you say categorically it is obstructive jaundice? These episodes happen for how long?
It lasts for about 10 days.
In 10 days you develop itching also. You develop everything.
She gives it.
So tell us some benign conditions in which a similar kind of a picture can happen.
Luminal obstruction due to stones.
So that would be
colicky.
It would be colicky.
You get Charcot's triad and colicky pain only. Yes. What is Charcot's triad?
Charcot's triad is upper abdomen, intermittent pain, fever and jaundice.
Intermittent pain, intermittent fever, intermittent jaundice. Is due to stone.
Yes, sir.
Now, is there something else which is benign and produces
benign,
obstructive?
She also complains of a lump, so it could be a pressure symptom, pressure effect of the, on the biliary tract that's causing the obstructive jaundice, which is relieved subsequently.
What is in your mind?
Okay, so one is that you are talking about a large stone at Hartman's which may be doing it, right?
If there is a stone,
third thing,
it will cry and the pain is different.
Yes, sir.
And you have specifically talked about history of contact with dog and all.
Yes, ma'am.
Why? Can that also cause jaundice or what?
Yes, ma'am. I was suspecting a large lump over 4 years to rule out a hydatid cyst.
Yes, so how can a patient of hydatid cyst present with jaundice, obstructive jaundice?
There are two ways, ma'am. Either if it ruptures into the biliary tract and then cause obstruction, which will again be associated with pain, biliary pain, or it could cause pressure symptoms over the biliary tract that causes.
So why is it that hydatid cysts rupture more than congenital cysts in the liver into the biliary tract?
Because of its large size, it...
No, size is not the reason. Because all these hydatid cysts are very high pressure cysts.
They are, plus their
so
walls
they erode.
Are not so thick.
Yes.
And that's also a factor.
They erode into the...
So they
well,
erode that, because
you've
of high
got
pressure.
A diagnosis in mind. Otherwise, you don't get a classical obstructive jaundice in a cyst which is... or the content of the daughter cyst which has gone into the... You get cholangitis. And what are the features? You get a Charcot's triad. A fever is, this is very brief because as it passes, so it's not a classical, so don't use that term. I would be very careful.
Yes, sir.
Move to examination.
The patient was examined after taking appropriate consent in the supine position in the presence of a chaperone. She was conscious, oriented and cooperative. She was moderately built with a BMI of 23.5. She was adequately hydrated and her performance status was 80 on Kanowski scale. There is no pallor, icterus, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. There are no signs of nutritional deficiencies. There were no evidence of any scratch marks. No signs of chronic liver disease were present. Her pulse was 82 per minute. Her BP was 127 by 80. She was afebrile and her respiratory rate was 18. This is an image of the patient. On inspection, an ill-defined lump is seen in the epigastric, umbilical, right hypochondrium and the left and the right lumbar region, which moves with respiration. The umbilicus is displaced downward and is stretched vertically. Two oval-shaped scars are seen over the lower abdomen on either sides of the midline. There are no dilated veins, no visible pulsations or peristalsis. The hernial orifices are normal. The external genitalia is normal. The spine and back is normal on inspection. On palpation, an intra-abdominal, intraperitoneal, well-defined lump of 20 to 15 centimeters occupying the right hypochondrium, right lumbar, epigastric, umbilical, extending into the right iliac regions, which is firm in consistency, which had rounded borders, with all borders clearly palpable. and the upper border is palpable just below the costal margin, and the lateral border extends till the right mid-axillary line, which is smooth surfaced, moved with respiration, and had side-to-side mobility. There were no pulsations over the lump, no lump palpable in other regions of the abdomen. The liver is not palpable. There was no renal angle fullness, and the spine and back were normal. On auscultation, normal bowel sounds are present and no sounds were heard over the lump. On percussion, the lump is dull and it is not continuous of the liver dullness. Rest of the abdomen is tympanic. The Virchow's lymph nodes are not enlarged. On digital rectal examination was normal. The povaginal examination was normal and the systemic examination was also normal. To summarize the history and examination, this is a 23-year-old woman who complains of a large 15 to 15 slow-growing lump in the upper outer region of her abdomen, associated with a continuous non-colicky pain, along with two episodes of obstructed jaundice 6 months and 3 months back that resolved spontaneously. On examination, a large, firm, smooth surface, intraperitoneal, well-defined lump occupying the right hypochondrium, right lumbar, epigastric, umbilical, right iliac, with all borders well palpable.
So,
my diagnosis is a 23-year-old woman with a large intraperitoneal abdominal lump, probably of benign etiology, most probably a mesenteric cyst arising from the transverse colon mesentery, or a hydatid cyst of the transverse colon mesentery, or a gist of the transverse colon.
Okay. What? How do you support the first one, second one, third one?
The mass, the mesenteric cyst, the transverse colon mesentery, because of its location and its large size, and ruled out any hydatid cyst arising from the liver because the upper margin was clearly palpable. Also, the it's an intra-abdominal swelling because it moves with respiration, and there is some mobility, side-to-side mobility associated with it. She has no bowel symptoms, so it's not arising from within the lumen of the bowel. Second,
how would this explain your jaundice, which you were insisting on so strongly?
Yes, sir. The only way a mesenteric cyst can explain the jaundice is the pressure effects on the CBD or the biliary apparatus.
Do you think that is possible? Where is mesentery and where is the biliary system? What is the attachment of mesentery?
The transverse mesentery.
Yeah. I'm talking about the mesenteric cyst.
Retroperitoneal.
No, it is. Mesentery is not retroperitoneal.
It's attached to transverse mesentery. Colon mesentery. Tell us from where to where does it extend? Transverse colon mesentery, the base of the mesentery.
The base extends from... I'm not sure.
Right, it starts from right hypochondrium, then it goes over the... crosses over the duodenum.
Yes, crosses over the duodenum and passes the left hypochondrium.
Then to the left. Hypochondrium, it's a horizontal
it can cause
line.
Pressure,
it can.
But it can't remain there.
Before it will cause jaundice, no?
So, yes. If it has to press the duct, it will have to press the duodenum,
yes, sir.
Before.
Yes, sir.
Because it cannot be going behind. So, there are no features of outlet obstruction. That's why, which of the three is explaining your jaundice more easily?
Hydatid cyst of the...
So you mean to, why did you specifically say hydatid cyst of transverse colon mesentery? Why so? Supposing I say it is hydatid cyst of the lesser omentum? Any problems?
Because the upper border is well palpable and it's away from the costal margin.
So what, even in the lesser omentum? And why specifically hydatid cyst of transverse? You mean to say hydatid cyst of transverse colon mesentery would happen primarily? We're going into very, very basics now that becomes theoretical. But then talking about primarily a hydatid cyst of transverse colon mesentery, tell us how can it happen? It cannot happen primarily.
All right. So we'll not waste time because clinically it is not making great sense. Can you think of something else easier? Your problem is that you could get above it.
Yes, sir.
And the other problem is it's not continuous with your liver dullness.
Yes, sir.
Otherwise your problem was over. That's what you wanted. Now, is it possible that you get a false sense of...
Yes, it is possible if our finger cannot get beyond the actual upper border of the margin and still continues with the liver edge.
Do you know it happens very frequently?
Yes, sir.
That the hydatid cyst is coming from behind,
yes.
Almost like a tongue,
tongue
pointing this way.
It could be a dropped hydatid from the liver.
Or it could have been a dropped hydatid from the liver. That's the second thing I was going to say. So, don't... always look for that continuity with the liver dullness. In any case, it is not all around that you can find it.
Yes, sir.
I'm not saying we should cook a diagnosis and create a situation. But what is most likely in your mind? These three look like the airy-fairy ways to take care of it. Gist of transverse colon. Okay, let me finish first this. Gist of, she has asked you already, hydrated cyst of the mesentery of transverse colon. Possible, but not probable.
Yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
And the gist of transverse colon?
Gist of transverse colon again.
That's a diagnosis which you, gist you are using, everybody is using to take care of something with the interrupt, the luminal features are not there,
yes.
But the lump, I want to fix it somewhere. Is it very common to see gists?
It's about only about 15% of.
So let's not unnecessarily get into difficult diagnosis. Let's make it simpler. Where is this located?
So it's
located. Go back to your picture. There you are. Okay? Now it's a large, huge lump, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Now, where is the costal margin? This is where it is actually dipping in. So many a times you are not able to appreciate. Is it? It's moving on respiration. So at the what could you have done to make sure that it's not a dropped hydrated cyst? You could have examined him, heard in a standing position.
I did.
Which is what I was waiting. Then this gap would be more clearly visible. And then you can go over the swelling and see actually whether it's completely free from liver.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes,
and it is known that liver may have one hydrated cyst. There is another one thrown into the peritoneal cavity, which has still got those flimsy connections and it's hanging. So if you were to look for some innocuous swelling, then your differential diagnosis could be all right. But what about your jaundice? So you're linking it to hepatobiliary system somewhere?
Yes, sir.
So isn't it more likely to be fitting into the hydrated cyst arising from the liver than the mesenteric transverse small colon mesentery?
Yes.
I'm comparing two scenarios.
Yes.
Which is more likely?
The liver hydrated is.
The only problem is you are not able to establish its connection with liver.
With the liver, sir.
So you can always mention it that clinically with such a large swelling, it may not be possible to. Could you get above it very clearly?
Yes, sir.
All around?
Yes, sir.
You could push it down?
Yes, sir. It was mobile side to side also.
No, side to side is all right. Up and down?
Up and down mobility.
Could there be anything else which is lying there and forms a connection between the stomach and the liver? Could it be lying on the omentum?
Yes, sir.
No, you're just trying to think now.
Yes, sir. It could
be. And transverse mesentery, hydrated cyst is also possible. And this description of your, is it possible that there are multiple hydrated cysts, this one is palpable. The others are in the liver and they are throwing the daughter cyst into the tract to produce that one effect there. And this is the lump that is possible. So they're all possible. But why do you say hydrated cyst in the first place?
So because of her history, a long-standing history of over 4 years, and she's well-preserved. She doesn't have any other symptoms.
There's also something called as an art of elimination.
Yes.
So eliminate like Sherlock Holmes would do. And then look at the probabilities. Why is it not malignant?
It's a young patient who otherwise has a history of slow growing with a
long history.
Long history of 4 years.
Young patient. Young. Next.
And this, it is firm in consistency. Mobile.
Consistency firm.
Mobile. Again, the size of the swelling.
And the size. Size is in favor or against?
So in this size, being asymptomatic and such a big size is for the favor of a
benign.
It
would be surprising. With large. If this was malignancy, it would have produced some
symptoms.
Some symptoms. So that's fine. It's a benign swelling in the abdomen. Then you are giving possibilities. Don't exclude liver hydrated cyst also as a possibility.
Yes, sir.
That's all I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
Gist is a possibility, yes. But why is it not gist? You will have to tell me.
Just her age is not in favor of
Yes. Cyst. And?
And the location of the...
What is the most common site for gist?
Stomach is the most
stomach?
Common. Then
is it stomach? No.
No, it's not the stomach.
Then
the small bowel is the next.
Then small bowel is the next.
Then the large bowel is most
common. So, age and the incidence being low, unlikely, it can still happen. So, gist is a diagnosis of exclusion. It's not a diagnosis that you give as the first diagnosis.
Yes, sir.
So, you exclude others and you can find gist.
Yes, sir.
All right, how do you proceed?
So, investigations to confirm, to support my diagnosis and to treat the patient depending on what it is. As an extension of my clinical examination, I'll first get an ultrasound abdomen. So by that we will get the organ of involvement, whether it's involving the liver or the hepatobiliary system. We'll also know its size, any other swellings in the abdomen, its character, whether it's...
Can ultrasound kill the issue?
Yes, sir.
What would be the appearance of hydatid cyst on ultrasound?
It appears as a multilocular cystic lesions with many daughter cysts inside a cystic.
It's classically described as a cyst within a cyst.
So, cyst within a cyst. And you've done an ultrasound and then you know the organ of
involvement. And then
you can proceed with further accordingly.
So ultrasound shows that there is a cyst within a cyst in the liver. Yes. And you find that there are multiple small hydatid cysts within the CBT and floating within the CBT.
Yes,
and the intrahepatic biliary channels are dilated and there are two or more cystic lesions in the lesser.
There is hydatid cyst now. What do you do?
If it involves the CBT, then it will
happen. Yes, I've told you the findings.
Yes,
rest, everything is normal. There is a cyst in the liver. There are some cysts in the lesser omentum. And plus, there are small cysts in the common bile duct.
So, because there are multiple cysts, we'll need further investigations to...
Like?
For the biliary tree, we'll need an MRCP of the biliary tree.
Okay, MRCP.
And for the intra-abdominal multiple cysts, we'll need a contrast-enhanced CT scan of the abdomen pelvis.
So, CT and MRCP. What next?
We'll proceed to eliminate the cysts within the CBD. Once MRCP is there, we'll do an ERCP. And the extraction of these cysts through this.
You straight away go ahead. What is the risk of dealing with cysts in the patient who has not been primed, who has not been treated?
We'll start her off with anti-ailments, albendazole.
How do you start on albendazole?
About a week before the surgery.
What is mandatory before you start the patient on albendazole?
LFT.
LFT is mandatory in all. What is mandatory? Please speak loudly. It's complete blood count. Why? Agranulocytosis. It causes agranulocytosis. So you must have the complete blood count. What is the dosage?
400 milligrams BD dose is given.
For how long?
Usually it's given in 3 cycles of 4 weeks each with a gap of 2 weeks in between.
Okay, you done, put the patient on albendazole. Does this patient need surgery urgently?
Since she is not in, she doesn't have obstructive features, then...
She gave you a scenario where there are daughter cysts in the common bile duct.
Common bile duct.
That could become some kind of an indication.
Yes, sir.
So what do you do? You said ERCP. That's what he said.
Yeah, but you mean to say by ERCP you would clear the CBD of the daughter cysts and... Do you think surgery is a better option or do you think ERCP in these cases? Because you mean to say you'll be able to extract these hydatid cysts intact or you want them to rupture and then to infect and cause generalized hydatidosis?
Again, if you're planning for a surgery, there is still a complication of where to open the CBD.
No, you can't do surgery right now straight away.
Yes.
That I agree with you because surgery will have its own problems with the scolecystal agents that you want to use. Because you may introduce cholangitis of sclerosing cholangitis, which is deadly.
Yes.
The only advantage of, only re-indication for putting in a scope would be to stent it so that you can get the drainage all right.
Yes.
And then you can live to fight another day. Hydatid cysts don't kill unless you kill them. That is, you puncture it, it gets released, a histamine response, patient dies. Even when you are doing the stenting, you will make sure that your patient is covered for anaphylaxis.
Yes.
So you should be adequately covering this patient up with steroids as well as the antihistaminic agents. You should be ready with it. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, decompression is required only if the patient is jaundiced and it is bothering. Otherwise, like you saw in your patient, it is intermittent. It gets relieved on its own. And the principle of relief is just the same as in stone. Because once there is obstruction, the proximal part dilates. And then it falls back and there is a passage. With that, it becomes possible to manage it. There is no, it doesn't kill that way.
Yes.
But if the decompression is required, it has to be with precautions. Ideally, patient should be covered with albendazole and then you should go for it. What else? Now, when you have decided to do surgery, the endoscopic approach for just the cyst is not going to help because there is a connection somewhere.
Yes, sir.
So, what is the approach? Mostly open surgery or laparoscopically going for the high-tech
treatment. How do you establish on the table when you've done, say, a laparotomy,
yes,
between the cyst and the biliary channels or the common bile duct, whether there is any communication of the main cyst with the biliary channel or not?
What do you do when you find a cyst on the table? You opened up, you're preparing.
There are two methods, ma'am. Either we can
tell me the second one. There are 200 methods.
Yes, sir. We aspirate, we take a needle.
Don't. Take me through the steps. You open the abdomen.
Open the abdomen. Then the cyst is, if the cyst is clearly visible in the liver, first we take a needle.
What packs are used?
We use packs. Butadiene soaked packs.
Black or dark colored? Why?
So the white colored cysts are clearly visible.
But the cyst is white so that you can see.
See this.
Then what do you do? Junaid, Arush, anyone? You localize this. I don't agree with him. He's saying you put in a needle. Arush, yes? Next. Now?
So we take scolicide lesions, betadine soak mops.
No, we don't do that. So we use black or dark packs. Okay, a green also are fine. That's one thing you need to be careful. The packs are not white. Next, if you are preparing to put in a needle, you don't just puncture, you need to have some kind of a stay, might drop in. When you put in a needle, you aspirate to see whether it's a clear fluid or bile mixed, or there is hemorrhage.
Yes,
okay, now if it is bile mixed, do you introduce a scolicidal agent? You're saying you introduce, so?
No, sir.
So the best way that is described to see communication is, if at all you were expecting a large communication, say with the main
biliary. Most communications are very minor.
Minor.
And the reverse process which he was describing,
yes,
it doesn't work out.
You can do an intraoperative cholangiogram if
it's no, not intraoperative, it won't show. Usually you need to inject air to see whether there is a communication. You fill the cyst cavity and you inject air in the biliary channel, and if there is bubbling, that's the best way to establish a large communication, if it is there.
Small communications are there mostly.
Yeah.
So you put in a needle, aspirate, I'm completing it, and if it is bile stain, you aspirate, all right, don't inject scolicidal agents. This is the case for a capitonage,
yes,
where you'll have to pack it with omentum and seal it. So you get everything out, you've taken care of it, then you put in a, best is MTP cannula, which you get, the plastic one. Once you introduce that, it can suck out all the daughters, all the fluid. Sometimes towards the end, the bile comes. Okay? Now, if there's a little bit of bile coming, you open up the cyst and you're able to see the communication. And with 3-0 vicryl, you underrun all of them. Or the better option is to do TCP. What is that? Total cystopericystectomy, where you will go outside the cyst, almost like a liver resection, where you will ligate and clip them even before they enter. That is a better chance of preventing a leak. So TCP is with lower leaks of the bile. But if you cannot do it, you've done a resection of the cyst, you pack it with omentum, otherwise the bowel can go and produce internal herniation, or the bile will keep leaking. You put the sutures all around, put it inside, seal it from above, what is called as capitonage. The omentum serves as a pressure
momentum
and a scavenger at the same time. Instead of packing the cavity, packing is a wrong method. You're packing it with omentum, which keeps draining the bile out and keeps the pressure intact and throws opsonins. So that is what you do to take care that you don't cause any collection of bile there.
Yes,
you get the point?
Yes, sir.
But don't introduce a scolicidal agent in, yes, these patients. Which scolicidal agent you have seen? Suppose there is no connection, you inject?
10% betadine can be used, cetrimide can be used, chlorhexidine can be used, hypertonic saline.
Hypertonic saline can also be used, and you again make sure there is no spillage. And that's where betadine is messy. A lot of people don't use it. And most people use hypertonic saline, which is a very simple way to do it. And then you can close it. Like I said, you shouldn't go beyond it. Total cystopericystectomy or the capitonage, or leaving it open is also an option. Leaving a drain there is also an option. The second difference, we just got a minute with you.
Yes, sir.
Was cyst from the transverse colon. The management would not change anyway. Now, I think that should take care of it. Gist of transverse colon, what more investigation you would do? I'm trying to give you as many questions pertaining to a lump in that region. Even in the obstructive jaundice case yesterday, I tried to give you questions. If I'm not getting an answer, at least you should know what all can be asked. Yes.
For the gist of a transverse colon, after getting the CT scan, we can look for a biopsy, endoscopic guided biopsy.
How would you get endoscopic biopsy in a gist which is arising from transverse colon? You mean colonoscopy?
Colonoscopy.
But it is outside, yes, so you won't...
You can use an endoscopy ultrasound guided...
Contraindicated, you advance the stage of gist. It is not in, it doesn't start in the mucosa, no? So you
Is it a disease of the mucosa?
No, sir, it's not a disease of the mucosa, but an ultrasound guided, endoscopic ultrasound guided.
It is recommended you can do an EUS, FNA, but it's very cumbersome.
Yes, sir.
Can you do some other tests? Is there any CT feature which is suggestive of gist? Anybody? What are the CT features that will suggest that it is gist?
The extra luminal location of the tumor.
One is location, yes.
The size of the tumor.
Vascularity.
And vascular.
You need to look for, yes, it's a vascularized extramural growth is taken as gist unless proven otherwise. Is there some genetic test that you can do or markers that you can do?
Yes, sir.
Which are those?
CD117, CD34. CD117 is more common.
Would the treatment be different? Or you'll still be doing exploratory laparotomy?
We'll still be doing an exploratory laparotomy.
Can you do diagnostic laparoscopy beforehand? Yeah. That can help.
That can
and help. Since a lot of them have some pedunculated appearance, yes, you can clip and come out. Do you need to do lymph node dissection?
No, sir, we don't. Ideally, we just need to achieve our R0.
How much dissection. Margin do we need for gist anywhere?
We need an R0 dissection.
So we don't really need to go
margin,
wide.
Wide margin.
So you can do endoscopic wedge dissections, yes, and get a clear margin. Frozen is mandatory. Yes, and what do you put these patients on?
Imatinib post-op for about 3 years.
And when do you stop them, imatinib?
So we can monitor the, I mean, there's no recurrence.
So we don't know when to stop.
Usually
actually.
3 years, they say.
Nobody knows.
Yes.
Till the patient actually gets fed up.
Yes.
It goes on and on. What is imatinib, by the way?
It's a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, sir.
So you always use the word TKIs, and then you can name the drug. They have other drugs also, which are there. Okay, round of applause for him. Thank you very much.